It is the day of Pentecost. It is the day when we recognize that the Holy Spirit came down upon the disciples. They described it in Luke as tongues of fire laying upon their head. It's kind of what happened to my hair on top of my head. And it talks about a violent wind rushing through. We've heard violent winds and how loud and how even frightening they can be. The power of the Holy Spirit came down. The Holy Spirit himself came down on this day. We oftentimes think about God, do we not? We think about the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. When we think of God as the Father, we have all kinds of images that we can give. And if I were to have a little quiz for you right now and I asked you what names or what kind of things does the Father do, does the Holy Father in heaven do? You could name them. He is the God of love. He is the one who is our creator. You could give many more descriptors. If I asked about Jesus, well, you'd even give more, because we have several biographies of his life in the Bible, and because we have been taught the stories of Jesus and learned about his presence, his physical presence with us here on earth, it is easy to come up with so many descriptions of who Jesus was. But if I were, as that last final question on your test, asked you who the Holy Spirit is, how could you describe the Holy Spirit? I suspect that, like many people, you would be a little bit more perplexed about what to come up with. The Holy Spirit is that part of God that is present in our lives. And the Holy Spirit is described as wind and fire. Two very difficult things to contend with. We can't even see the wind most days. And fire is so unpredictable. It describes for sure the mysteriousness of the Holy Spirit. But for most of us, we've never grasped an understanding of the Holy Spirit, and we've never really allowed him to become a part of our lives. We thank God for his love. We thank Jesus as our Savior and our Lord, the giver of our salvation. And we come to the Holy Spirit and we thank God for the Holy Spirit and ask him to fill us with the Holy Spirit, but we never enable that power in us to be unleashed. So how can we just talk about the Holy Spirit on this day when he comes down, on this day when 3,000 believers came to 3,000 people came to be believers, and the Church of Jesus Christ was formed on this day. It's the historic beginning of the church. How do we talk about the Holy Spirit and understand who he is and what he does? Well, I think Francis Buford might be of a little bit of help to us. Francis Buford was in the British Royal Navy, and he was in the Navy in 1805. So if his name isn't familiar to you, if it doesn't come rolling back to your mind right away, it's probably because you never heard of him. But what he did was instrumental in navigation on the seas, because he felt that if they could somehow quantify the wind and quantify, therefore, the waves, they could begin to navigate much more accurately on the seas. So he went about trying to describe the wind and putting different measurements to it that the captains of the ships and the navigators of the ships could compute the direction in their day so that they could go on course. It came to be known as the Buford scale. And he talks about various strengths of the wind. He talks about a calm wind. He talks about a strong breeze. He talks about gale force winds. He talks about hurricanes. And he has other increments in between. This morning, I'd like to talk about the Holy Spirit. This Holy Spirit who comes in a mighty and violent wind, in the sense of Buford's scale. I'm calling it the Spirit scale. And we begin by that calm presence of the wind, that real gentle breeze that if you're sitting on your deck or patio, maybe yesterday you could have felt that breeze, and it was so refreshing. But it's a breeze that's so calm that a campfire would, the smoke would simply go up vertically. There would be no push either direction. The calmness of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I'm sending you." And with that, he breathed on his disciples the Holy Spirit. He wants us to have the calm peace of the Holy Spirit, a calm peace that can resonate in our souls, that allows us to be reassured that the presence of the Lord is with us. As Methodists, we talk about the assurance of faith, and that assurance is something that we can have. An awareness that God is with us, an awareness that Christ has saved us, an awareness that He is our Savior, an awareness of our salvation. And that presence of God gives us a peace which calms our spirit and restores our minds. When I think about the peace of God coming upon me in the Holy Spirit, He also comes with a sense of purpose. As the Father sent me, so I'm sending you. Jesus said, here he is, the Holy Spirit. He breathes on them because he wanted them to have an understanding of the purpose that he had gathered them together 3 years earlier, that he was going to enable them to have on this day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came in a powerful way, exploded on the scene as Peter preached, that 3,000 people came to believe, as the disciples began to speak in tongues that they were unfamiliar with, but they turned out to be languages that others could understand. This is a day in which an explosive power of God appeared on earth, not only to 12 disciples, but to more than 3,000 who came to believe and others who were gathered that day. Can you imagine the power of God in that moment? As God has sent me here, Jesus said, I'm sending you into the world. He gives us a sense of peace and calmness. But on this day, when you receive the Holy Spirit in your life and allow Him to begin to work in you, you begin to have a sense of your life. You can know that purpose through the gifts of the Spirit and allow God to be using you in your very unique and special way as God has formed you to do the work of His kingdom. Oh, to have the calmness of the Spirit, that peace, that reassurance, and that purpose that guides our lives. But then there's the strong breeze of the Holy Spirit. It's when that breeze is going between 25 and 31 miles an hour. And at that time, the umbrellas may be hard to difficult manage. It may be hard to hold the umbrella. And the leaves and branches begin to shake much more strongly. The strong breeze of the Holy Spirit. We see that time and again in the scriptures. But stands out in particular fashion in the Holy Spirit as he moved through the Old Testament. We read over and over again that the Spirit of God came to the elders, for instance, in Numbers 11, 25. Balaam in Numbers 24, 22. In Gideon, in Judges, as the power of God, the Spirit of God came upon Gideon. And God then worked with him until he formed a mighty army, not of 10,000, but of 300. And they went against the Midians, and they defeated the Midians. But it was the power of the Spirit of God that came upon Gideon. And if we read about Samson in Judges 13, 25, it was Samson who had the Spirit begin to stir in him as a young child. And we know that Samson grew up to be one of the most powerful man ever. Who can forget the Spirit of God falling upon Saul in 1 Samuel 10:10, and then later as Saul placed his hands upon David, David had the Spirit of God upon him in 1 Samuel 16:13. These are just incidents. These are just examples of the Spirit of God coming upon a person for a unique task or a unique mission. And sometimes that's how God works in us. We have suddenly, not a nudge, but more like a sense of urgency, a sense of need to do this, a sense of compelling feeling that we have to go and do this one thing. We have to go and reach out to this person. We have to go and visit this person. We have to go and do whatever it is the Lord is nudging us to do. Sometimes that happens individually. Sometimes that happens in the life of our churches and in the life of groups of people. In this church, in Cherry Lane Church, a few years back Pocono Plateau was building cabins. And the men of this church got together and They had some construction background. Fortunately, I wasn't their pastor at the time. And if I was, they would not have invited me. But they went and they built not one of the cabins at Pocono Plateau. They built four of those cabins. They did a task beyond what they had imagined that they were going to do. One of the gentlemen who talked to me about it was still in awe of the fact that they did so many of them when they only expected to do one. It was because they had a sense of the strong breeze of the Holy Spirit. It was the Lord saying, you can do this. I want you to do this. I'm sending you to do this, this special task, this mission. Over the last number of years, this church has adopted children from the school district or nearby, children who would not have food for the weekend, children who could be identified as ones who would be hungry. And so on a weekly basis, this church has gathered food together and put them in backpacks. We call it blessing in a backpack. And they have enough food in that backpack to feed them over the weekend during the school year. What a powerful, wonderful message and ministry that is. But these people, these ladies, and in effect, the missions team of our church, they began with a few kids, and then more kids, and then more kids. And when I came here, there were 39 kids, and they were concerned that they were going to have enough money for 39 kids. When we started school in the fall, before it was closed, we were up to 40, and then 41, 42, and finally, we were feeding 43 children every weekend. Here's the amazing thing. I was worried about whether we were going to be able to pay for 43 children's meals for a complete weekend every week. We're a small church, after all. Remember, the Israelites, worried about food, had manna day after day after day provided for them. Remember Elijah and the need for the oil that was provided day after day after day for the widow so that they could provide for food? Well, what I found out was that we not only had enough money, but we've had more money come in than the need had presented itself. We could have taken more kids in as that number grew. And I can only imagine how it will be this fall. When school begins again, the number of children that will need to be fed, and I believe in a God who will provide for that need. And he has done so because the women of this church, the missions team of this church, has had a feeling that they needed to help these children, a feeling that they needed to help feed them. It was the strong breeze of the Holy Spirit working in them in a particular mission, in a particular task. And he not only fulfilled that mission by helping the children have full bellies, but he also fulfilled a sense of accomplishment and joy in serving the Lord and seeing him at work in them in ways that were beyond what they ever imagined. This is the God who pours out his Holy Spirit on us today to give us peace, to give us a sense of purpose, but also to give us at times a powerful sense of his presence that we are supposed to do one particular task or mission. Don't miss it when God's speaking to you in your head or speaking to you in your heart. And over and over and over again, an idea or a person comes to mind and you just ignore it. No, that's the Spirit of God speaking in you so you can respond to him. This is how the Holy Spirit works in us, but he doesn't stop at a small breeze. The Holy Spirit comes upon us in that violent wind like a gale storm when the winds get between 32 and 63 miles per hour. And when that happens, the large trees sway, branches break off, and even some trees are uprooted. Gale force winds. We read in Luke 10. When Jesus had sent out the 72 and they came back after they had been in ministry, it says that the 72 returned with joy and they said to Jesus, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. And Jesus replied, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. I have given you the authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm you. Those are the words of Jesus, given the authority in his name to be able to trample upon snakes. Now, where I live, there are plenty of snakes, and I see some of my friends complaining about the presence of snakes. all the time on Facebook. But as your pastor, I just want to encourage you not to go out into the woods and look for snakes so you can just go ahead and trample on them. Live by my motto, live and let live. Leave the snakes alone, but grasp the authority of Jesus' name. Grasp the authority of Jesus' name to overcome all the power of the enemy. That power of the enemy works in us in the most insidious ways. It kind of creeps into us until we are suddenly kind of confined and imprisoned by it. For many, it's a sense of self-doubt or a low sense of self-worth. Sometimes it's a feeling that you are just worthless, or one failure just leads to another, that nothing's ever going to go right in your life. And this is the kind of thinking that grasps hold of us. And when we take the authority in Jesus' name and we say, Satan, flee from me, he literally runs, because in the name of Jesus, Satan has no power. So in whatever ways you have felt the presence of the enemy speaking to you and putting you down and holding you back and making you feel helpless in life, that is the enemy, and define it and explain it and recognize it, because it is the power of the Holy Spirit who comes along, and Jesus gives you the authority to use that Holy Spirit power in his name to cast out fear, to cast out self-doubt, to claim that you are not only worthy, but that you are a child of the Most High God who is blessed and highly favored by God. Oh, those gale force winds. So many lives have been changed when they move from believing in Jesus and being saved by the power of Jesus' name, accepting him as their Savior, to the point when they begin to allow the Holy Spirit to work in them to change their lives, to change their thinking, to change their mindset, to change their feelings, so that they can live in victory as Jesus wants us to live. Claim the authority that Jesus has given you in his name, and use the power of the Holy Spirit. I should be done, shouldn't I? It sounds like enough power. But Buford went on to talk about hurricanes. We know hurricanes. Anything between 75 miles an hour up to over 200 miles per hour. Most of us have not lived through one, but we have seen vividly the effects of hurricanes and how much power they have. It's sometimes described as having the energy of a 10 megaton bomb exploding like every 20 minutes. In 2 Corinthians, Paul writes in the 10th chapter, verses 3 to 5, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of this world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds." To demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedience to Christ. We have the power, the divine power, to demolish strongholds. Those are powerful words. I think of the prayers that we had over years, 70 years, until the Berlin Wall came crumbling down. I think of the powers now for centuries as we have prayed for people of various colors to live in peace and unity as brothers and sisters in a world where we are no longer separated by visions of our color or by our ethnicity. But instead, we are bound together by the Spirit of God. We do not work and fight with weapons of this world. We fight with the weapons of God, the weapons of God that give us divine power to demolish strongholds. Because we recognize that it isn't just about taking lives that should never be taken. It's about the principalities and powers. And Paul writes about that in Ephesians 12. He said, this isn't about blood, but it's about flesh and blood. It's about principalities and powers. It's about the spiritual world. We're always battling in the spiritual world. And we can have victory in a spiritual world. Victory to bring unity to God's people of every race and every tongue and every background. And we can have the unity of the Spirit as the brothers and sisters in Christ to rise above the disunity that we oftentimes have in our own churches. We have divine power to break down, to demolish strongholds. And that's in a personal level too. I have been amazed in my ministry over how often the power of God has been prayed over a son or a daughter who is bound by drug addiction and abuse. And they've been to rehabs and they have been free of it, and then they go back again. And we have prayed earnestly, we have prayed powerfully, we have prayed continuously, person here and person there, churches that all together praying for the same person, praying for that stronghold of drug abuse to be broken, to be demolished. And we have seen lives change. We have seen people freed from that. I have seen alcoholics who have been so driven to drink that they can't do anything else. It revolves around that. Their first love is their bottle, and they'll give up anything but it. But then we pray for them. I've seen spouses pray for a partner who is suffering from alcoholism, and they have one day given it up. The power of prayer to demolish strongholds is unbelievable, and the Church of Jesus Christ uses the power of prayer so effectively to demolish strongholds. I have seen in this church a child who had been healed by the power of prayer. And I know a woman who is walking free of cancer today because of the power of prayer and the treatments that she received. You see, when we begin to talk about the hurricane force of God's Holy Spirit, when we are putting the full power of God's Spirit into something, we are talking about a powerful thing that demolishes the strongholds of our lives. What is it for you that is that stronghold? Is it bitterness or contempt? Is it anger or hatred? Do you have a substance problem or a physical abuse problem? Do you struggle with a depression that never seems to be lifted? Open yourself up to the power of the Holy Spirit. Invite others in to pray with you and for you so that those strongholds can be demolished in your life. Oh, the power of the Holy Spirit came down as a violent wind, our scripture says, on this day, the day of Pentecost. It came and it brought peace and it brought purpose to the disciples, and it brings peace and purpose to us. It comes as a strong breeze to motivate us and to call us into a particular ministry and mission to help someone else. It uses us in powerful ways, giving us the authority in Jesus' name to overcome anything that the enemy will throw at us. And that powerful wind of the Holy Spirit comes with hurricane force wind and power to demolish strongholds. We never know what God can do, but we know this: what is impossible for us is possible for God. That even what Jesus did in this earth, he said, you can do even greater things than me. And Paul encourages us to ask for things, and that God is more willing to give than we can even ask or imagine. So I invite you today to begin to see that third person of the Trinity, to see the Holy Spirit as in a powerful force inside of you that you can utilize in these ways, not only to overcome and have a great spiritual life inside, but also to make a world of impact in the lives of others.